see the innocent Son of God punished there for us, rescuing us with his blood. Come see the healer of wounded souls, crucified for us, broken there to make us whole.
Welcome everyone to Christchurch on this glorious Easter morning. You'll see a photograph a little bit later on of what the sunrise was like down at the shore. It really was. I think it's the first time I've been doing the sunrise service and actually seen the sun. So, for the past 7 days, we've taken this journey together through Holy Week, haven't we? We've witnessed the excitement of the crowds on Palm Sunday, rejoicing because they thought their king, their redeemer, the conqueror, had come. And then we remembered how they turned against him, and we shared a Maundy-Thursday supper together and remembered the events of that night and how powerful it was for Jesus to share that meal with his friends, knowing what was to come. And then we had the walk of witness on Friday, joining with the other churches and then celebrating with them that quiet service of remembrance, that powerful service. And then here in church. And then today, witnessing the sunrise and rejoicing to know that Christ is risen, he is ruling, he is reigning. So we're here to celebrate this morning. And all the words, as usual, will be up on the screen. If they are in white, they're generally words that I say. And if they're in yellow, they're words that we say together. So as we come to worship this morning, let's invite one another into the celebration as we ask our risen Lord to fill us with his presence. Alleluia. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. We are risen with Christ. The Lord is risen. Eternal life is ours. The Lord is risen. Death has met its master. The Lord is risen. The way to heaven is open. The Lord is risen. Alleluia. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. And we're going to continue to praise as we sing the words of our first song, that glorious news we have come to celebrate. Jesus Christ is risen today. It is a service of Holy Communion today. And we would normally say together, call it for purity at this point, inviting God through the power of the Holy Spirit to enter into our worship, to make us joyful and able to hear from him as we praise and worship him. But this morning, as we remember that the cross and the tomb are empty, we're going to say together the Easter Collect. Christ is alive. And so we pray. God of glory, by the raising of your Son, you have broken the chains of death and hell. Fill your church with faith and hope, for a new day has dawned, and the way to life shines open in our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Do please take a seat as we come to a few notices, things that are in our Watson. Hopefully, those of you who normally take the walks on have seen a copy. I think there are some available at the back as well. Just a few things to draw to your attention. The first is that is a working party next week on Saturday morning at 10 o'clock. If you are able to join us to do some litter picking, some general tidying up, as well as any other tasks that might be, there is a sign-up sheet at the back, so you can have a glance, see what kind of things might be on offer. All are welcome. A final reminder that if you're planning to come to the church weekend away, please do let Ninda know and return your forms as soon as possible, because a decision needs to be taken as to whether or not we have enough people to go. If we're not able to go this year, it will be a real, real sadness for those who love to go. But so if you're thinking about it, let Ninda know, just in case it slipped your attention. Another reminder that the bereavement journey starts on April the 8th. There are quite a number of people already signed up for this, but it's not too late if you or you know someone who might benefit from this opportunity, then please do ring the office or speak to Lindsay or Jane and let them know. Looking a little bit further ahead, Sunday the 28th of April at 1 p.m, it is our APCM. And now we are looking for candidates, nominations for the posts of the PCC reps, as well as Deanery Synod reps, and, sad to say, wardens. Now, I know you've just really all been praying very hard and thinking about this, and that by the end of today, there'll be two or three names on the list. I can see the enthusiasm. But do please be thinking and praying. So we've got PCC members, Deanery Synod reps, and church wardens. So to be thinking and praying about those over the coming weeks. Think that's all the notices? We know that God is love, and that God loves all that he has made. He loves you, he loves me. Jesus showed that love on the cross when he died to deal with sin and rose again, defeating death and restoring us to God. By Jesus' life and in his own words, we know that he will never turn away any that come to him. But we know too that our lives are far from perfect. We know we all make mistakes. And so it's good actually to clear that clutter from that just blocks up, gets in the way of our relationship. And so that's what we do week by week as we come to church. We give to God those things that we've done as a church family, those things we've done as individuals, give them to him. Say sorry, knowing that he has dealt with them, that we are forgiven, that we are restored, we are redeemed. So let's do that now. O Jesus Christ, risen Master and triumphant Lord, we come to you in sorrow for our sins and confess to you our weakness and unbelief. We have lived by our own strength and not by the power of your resurrection. In your mercy, forgive us. Lord, hear us and help us. We have lived by the light of our own eyes as faithless and not believing. In your mercy, forgive us. Lord, hear us and help us. We have lived for this world alone and doubted our home in heaven. In your mercy, forgive us. Lord, hear us and help us. God's salvation plan, wrought in love, born in pain, paid in sacrifice, fulfilled in Christ, risen and alive. So let's stand to sing. See what a morning.
Door.
please do take a seat. Before we have our reading, I have some banns of marriage to publish. I publish the banns of marriage between Sean Moore and Laura Jo McCarthy, both of this parish. This is for the third time of asking. If anyone knows any reason in law why they may not marry, you are to declare it. Let's pray for them now. Father God, we thank you so much for the blessing of marriage. And as this young couple prepare to set out on this journey together, we pray your blessing in their final preparations, your presence on the day, and your purposes for them to fill and inspire them in the days to come. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And now Julie's going to come and bring us our reading.
This reading is taken from John chapter 20, verses 1 to 18, which can be found on page 1089 of the Pew Bibles. The empty tomb. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from the scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white, seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you've put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned towards him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. This is the gospel of Christ.
Morning, everyone. What a change it is to be at this time of the day. It's early for some. It's late for others. It's very late for some of us who are out at 6:30. Let's pray together. Lord, bless us on this Easter day with your presence and your word to us, that we may hear you speak to us and in us of your risen life, of your true reality. Lord, speak to us and cast away our doubts and fill us with love and truth this day. Amen. Who likes change? See, Trace does. She keeps saying to me, "I've been trying to change you for years." I don't know whether it's changing my character or changing my person. Who likes change? So we're here at 10 o'clock. What's that, love?
I failed.
You failed. Yeah, this is true. Some people like change, some people don't. Some people like the surety, the stability, the certainty that things will never change. And yet change is inevitable. C.S. Lewis actually made the point that how we psychologically think about that speaks to us of the reality of God, because we want everything to remain the same forever. That's like eternity. And yet things change. That's just reality. And yet we long for something that is permanent and real and reliable and stable and never changing. God? Which is why we always get surprised, don't we, by growth. When children grow up, we say, wow, you've grown like we weren't expecting them to. And then they turn into middle-aged men, and we say, wow, you've grown. Change. Water into... See, you're all hopeful. Ice. Snow. Just because you were in church or being really hopeful. Seeds into... that's an acorn tree. That's what that is. Yeah. You should know, you put this PowerPoint together years ago. This is for all the men in the room. It's your cat. It's, who's got a cat like this? Or a dog like this? Yeah. Angry to... Smiley. Sad to... You don't like cats.
No.
Hands up if you like cats.
No.
Hands up if you don't like cats. Hands up if you're stuck with cats. Change. Circumstance. The rest of the world thinks we're bonkers for being here. Let them. Fight and talk over here. Let them. What is it that brings us here? That's true Superman. The real one. Change. Do you know, as Debbie was rehearsing everything we've done in the last week, it's been quite a week. I feel as though I've done a whole day's work in 1 week. Some people think this, everything that we do is just nonsense. Jesus didn't exist. Jesus didn't die. Actually, some faiths that teach that Jesus didn't die on the cross, somebody else died in his place, Joseph of Arimathea. You have to be careful with this, how much you say. But crucifixion's not a holiday in the park, a walk in the park. Neither is the scourging. Some people think that Jesus woke up in the tomb like with a hangover, thinking, where am I? What am I? Why am I here? And escaped. And that was the story of the resurrection. Do you think that has any credibility?
No.
It was called the swoon theory. It was believed by academics. Things change. No one holds to that these days. It's gone well out of fashion. Jesus died. And we enter into that through Maundy, Thursday and Good Friday, and we feel something of the terror and the depth of that and what that means. We have a cross and a tomb and a stone and an empty space. How do we understand this change? Because if this didn't happen, everything we do here needs to be replaced by a lie-in. We're wasting our time. Paul said as much in 1 Corinthians 15. We are more to be pitied if Christ is not raised. Tomb, stone, emptiness. This is what we teach. Is this what we believe? Hands up if you think this is what we believe. Hands up if you don't. This is not what we believe. It's part of what we believe. The tomb is empty. Why? Because they nicked his body. It's one of the arguments. They came in the night and decided to make up a story of their risen Messiah. So they others found the tomb empty. The Romans pinched the body. The Jewish leaders pinched the body. This is stuff that you could read 100 years ago, published by academics, to try and get round this one fact, because they didn't like the change. And they would come up with all kinds of other stories, outlandish ones, as far-fetched as they could possibly be. And we're going to think some more about these. He was buried. The significant thing about this is he was buried in the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. Nowadays, historians, and theologians, and philosophers do not doubt any of these bits. The reason being is, in the text, there is Joseph of Arimathea, a leading member of the Sanhedrin, or Pharisees, I've forgotten which one, ruling leaders, Jewish leaders. If that wasn't historically credible, you wouldn't put it in. They're the other side of the force. They're the people that put Jesus to death along with the Romans and the crowd. But you name a man who belongs to the ruling elite as giving his own private tomb space. And what they used to say was this was all made up because criminals were never given a burial. They were left for dead and disposed of in that way. And that was believed and argued until they find texts in Quran and others that talk about you should bury criminals. And Jews did. So it blew that straight out the water. What they said was this was made up because that never happened until they found texts that say it did happen. And you mention a Jewish leader who comes and gives his wealth away. And this is part of the original story. What you have to realize is all these bits were there from the very beginning and they were not added on later. There's no text where you get part of it and then another bit and another bit, you know, later on. They're all there in all the Gospels. In various ways, but right from the very beginning. There's no bits of Luke that miss bits out and bits of John that miss bits out. The whole thing is there. Guarded by these guys. The story that they came and pinched the body is fantastic in itself. Because I'm not sure many of us would want to take one of these on. And in fact, Roman soldiers, if they lost their prisoner, were killed. So to mention these again puts the whole story into disrepute if it didn't happen. You're mentioning the bad guys. And remember, they're still around when the story was being told. Found by. Ta-da! We've just read this story. The fullest one in the Gospels, Mary. Does anybody know the significance of this? Historically, besides you, Trace. You've won the car. Is anyone shocked by this? If you read 1 Corinthians 15, where Paul is talking about the resurrection, he mentions, not only are we stupid if Jesus didn't die, rise, and we're proclaiming this, but it was seen by 500 people. And they mentions all the men. Because that would have been credible. I do hope those of you who are female and identify as such are voting when you can, because a whole pile of women gave their life for you to vote, and you're all thinking, what on earth is he going on about on Easter Day? Do you take that seriously, or just to sit at home? I'm talking to the ladies, the women. Do you vote?
Yes.
Is it important?
Yes.
Okay. You've only had it for about 100 and so years, haven't you?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't make jokes about the good old days, but I'll get killed. Anyway, go on. It's important. 2,000 years ago, if you were a woman, you could not testify in court legally or be a witness to anything with any reputable say-so. No evidence. Which is why in 1 Corinthians 15, Paul is very careful to airbrush the women out. Not because he's a misogynist, because he's surrounded by women, but he's talking about a tradition that will be transcultural, that will move around. You know, if you're going to talk football teams, who are you going to talk about as top of the league? You're not going to talk about certain ones that are supported in this room against others, are you? Thank you, Ron. But do you know what I mean? You would talk about, if you were setting a standard for something, what is the gold standard, you'd mention the ones at the top that were respectable. But the Gospels say how it happened. Now, I'm not saying Paul was wrong at all. I do not believe that for one second. It's being crafted carefully, and Paul is receiving the tradition as well in his writing. Women were not allowed to be witnesses. Ooh. Who put this here? This wasn't here when I started, but now it's here. Which means if you were writing a story about an incredible event, you would not put something that was equally incredible in and unbelievable. Women speaking the truth to men. This is really important. And we don't even see it, because it's just in the text, there's no explanation, and we're used to fairly standard equality now. But if the thing was a big fat lie, you wouldn't put this change in. One of the arguments is the women were silly. This was written down years ago. It's not believed anymore, but skeptical scholars used to say, they went to the wrong tomb. Excuse me, is Jesus in? Oh no, he's next door. And the tomb was empty because they'd burgled the wrong place. They went to the wrong tomb. You can see how silly some of these arguments are, but they were believed because they couldn't stand the change. Here's the big change. You've seen the women. Look at the blokes. Well, he's dead. Back to fishing. But he died terribly, so I'm hiding. I'm cowering. I was identified with him publicly. I was seen with him. That is going to happen to me. There's a change. So I'll hide. Who likes change? And yet Jesus appears. Cheer up, boys. That's the paraphrase of do not be afraid. This is what we proclaim. We believe the tomb was empty. We proclaim the risen Christ, that he is risen. Which is why Peter is out on the streets 40 days later. A change. Do you know this change? Have you experienced this change? I'm not talking about church. I'm talking about this reality. I read a quote from John Piper online. It's very John Piper. There's a world of difference between the Christianity that says, if I go to church, I risk being imprisoned and killed, and my family and children, with the Christianity that says, if I go to church, I'm going to have to miss football. There's a world of difference. These faced what they were hiding from. Persecution, crucifixion, and terror. And yet, they were from hiding away to on the streets. What was the change? Something important, significant, and powerful happened. Because you don't stand up and say a lie with passion in face of persecution for the very thing you know you're lying about. You might if you get some of the gain, but not when you know you and everybody else around you that you love and everything you hold dear and your business and your family are going to be killed. There was a change. What caused the change? This is where it gets weird. Now, I love this bit, and I'm going to tell you a bit about it, and then we're going to think back about the story. What is this? Anybody know what this is? Hands of who believes in the Turing Trust. Hands are we not sure? Okay. Those of you who are of my age will remember in the late 70s when it was all over the news, weren't you, with the carbon dating and all that stuff. Things have moved on so much more. The fascinating thing about this, because of computers, is they know now, well, they knew in the 70s, it's a 3D image. It's not a painting. It's a photograph on a cloth. They know now what they carbon dated in the 1970s was a patch of repair from the Middle Ages. So the carbon dating was more or less right on the patch. They know and they have seen pollen from Palestine in this from the first century. The weave is consistent with the same, you'll know this, Gloria, with a pattern of the cloth of that era in that place in the first century. They can't do carbon dating because the Church of Rome won't let you take any more bits of it. but there's pollen stuck inside it from Palestine. There's other bits inside it from Palestine. The cloth is from Palestine. It shows pollen from everywhere else because you can track its pollen where it's been through its journey when it's been hidden and helped and boxed off and moved and in fire and everything else and repaired. You can follow that track in the cloth. The interesting thing is this picture. If this is authentic, that's Jesus. That's Jesus. And what they've done now is shown that that picture is put on the cloth by radiation, blasting through the cloth and moving through the cloth in a way that it makes a mark on one side of the cloth and on the other, and this is, remember, very fine, but not in the center of the cloth. It's not burnt, it's not destroyed, it's an image of light going through the cloth. They know this. This is being looked at. Do you find that a bit unusual? I believe it's authentic. I believe we have the very burial cloth of Christ that was found in the tomb, because you would take it, wouldn't you, if somebody died and it was suddenly missing. You'd take all their stuff and say, this is my son's stuff. This is my friend's stuff. You'd keep it safe. Fascinating image from the first century, done by radiation on a cloth with a 3D image that is moving through the cloth that we cannot replicate today with all our technology. That's a change. Jesus is alive. Is that what we proclaim? We proclaim that. Do we proclaim this? There's a huge problem with this. I believe it's authentic. I believe it's absolutely what it is. I have a book at home. There's one of the leading scholars looking at the shroud, and he spent 40 years doing, is a Jew. He's not a Christian. He believes it's Jesus. He believes it from the first century. He believes it's authentic. But because he's a Jew, he doesn't believe in the resurrection of the Messiah. This will take you so far, but not all the way. Because if you don't want to change, you'll stay stuck where you are. No matter what the evidence points to, but also something deeply significant. If you're a Christian in Africa, in the Far East, in China, in Native America, in Latin America, you'd have never seen this and believed. You'd never have access to this. We don't build our faith on this. This may help us and point to something, but the reality is Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. And we know this because the change is not just in the cloth. It's not just in the lives of those believers 2,000 years ago. It is now. The change for believers is you become born again. Which is why in the gospel story, Jesus said to Mary, don't hold on to me. Don't try and keep hold of me. I am physical and risen, but you can't keep me here. I have not yet ascended. The Spirit has not yet come. The change is not yet complete. This is the change. Where is the reality of the resurrection today? Right here. In your heart, your life, and mine, and not just in your heart because you've had a nice warm sherry at communion or a warm sing-song in church or a nice hug afterwards, but because the Lord is risen, he is risen indeed, and he changes the way you see life completely. That's what it means to be born again. Do you know the change? This is what Easter's about, nothing else. And we pray this for one another, with one another, in one another. This is what the church is about, to make this real. Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. So we're not here as historians. We're here as people raised with Christ and changed by him. Do you know this? But if you're wavering in your faith, this can help. All these other arguments can help. Because what we trust in, what we have faith in, is the evidence that is real. But the evidence needs to point to the reality of a risen life in Christ. For the Lord is risen. He is risen indeed. We have good news of great joy for all the earth. Let's pray together. Lord, bless us this Easter time. Show us what true change means. Not forced change, not temperamental change, not change because we like it or hate it, but because you have taken hold of us and enabled us to see life differently. And we thank you, Lord, that you've given us pointers and signs to your reality. But Lord, we pray that you bless us now with your Spirit and your truth, that we may believe you are risen in our lives. Amen.
There is a lot there for us to reflect on and to take on board and just be wowed by. We're going to stand and we're going to sing together. I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. But we're not just remembering that, we're remembering that Christ is alive. He is risen. He is with us. So let's stand and sing together.
The Son of God.
This is the God we worship. This is the God we praise. This is the God we believe in. Let's say together. We believe in God the Father, who created the world and all that is in it. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We believe in Jesus Christ, his Son, who came into our world as its Savior. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We believe in the Holy Spirit who gives life to the people of God. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. This is the faith of all Christians in all times and at all places. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lift our minds above earthly things. Set them on things above. Show us your glory and your power, that we may serve you gladly all our days. Amen. Please do take a seat as Peter comes to lead us in our prayers.
Let us pray. Almighty God, so blessed, so glorious, the Ancient of Days, almighty, victorious, thy great name we praise. Today we celebrate the resurrection of our Saviour Jesus. His death opened the way to everlasting life with you, the forgiveness of all our sins, and the hope of a new, clean life. The resurrection is the victory over death. Without this, we have no hope, no life, no way into your presence. The door is open, the invitation made, but it is nothing without a response from us. Help us to step through the open door, to confess our sins and accept the forgiveness on offer. Let us show through our words and actions the love, hope, and peace you offer, so that others will accept your invitation, make the commitment and step through the door to eternal life with you. We pray that your love and peace reaches throughout our broken world, that people will turn to you and away from the darkness. You are the light of the world. May we always reflect that light and bring your hope, peace, and love to all around us. Today and every day we stand in your victory, forgiven by your sacrifice, loved and comforted by you, enfolded in your arms. We pray for those who need to feel your love and peace at this time. Let them feel your presence, fill them with your strength, and surround them with your love. We can never thank you enough for what you have done for us. We offer you all we have and all we are in your service. Help us to live the life you have planned for us, to reach out to those around us, and to stand firm in the knowledge that thine is the victory, thine be the glory, living, conquering Son. Amen.
We're going to sing again, remembering not only Christ's victory on the cross, but that gift of new life for all, that life is lived now and forever. So let's stand to sing In Christ Alone. the risen Christ stood amongst his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." They were glad when they saw the Lord. Alleluia. Let's offer one another a sign of the peace. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. Almighty God, good Father to us all, your face is turned toward your world. In love, you gave us Jesus, your Son, to rescue us from sin and death. Your word goes out to call us home to the city where angels sing your praise. We join with them in heaven's song. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Father of all, we give you thanks for every gift that comes from heaven. To the darkness, Jesus came as your light. With signs of faith and words of hope, he touched untouchables with love and washed the guilty clean. This is his story. This is our song. Hosanna in the highest. The crowds came out to see your son, yet at the end they turned on him. On the night he was betrayed, he came to table with his friends to celebrate the freedom of your people. This is his story. This is our song. Hosanna in the highest. Jesus blessed you, Father, for the food. He took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and said, "This is my body given for you all." Then Jesus gave thanks for the wine. He took the cup, gave it, and said, "This is my blood shed for you all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." This is our story. This is our song. Hosanna in the highest. Therefore, Father, with this bread and with this cup, we celebrate the cross on which he died to set us free. Defying death, he rose again and is alive with you to plead for us and all the world. This is our story. This is our song. Hosanna in the highest. Send your Spirit on us now, that by these gifts we may feed on Christ with open eyes and hearts on fire. May we and all who share this bread offer ourselves to live for you and be welcomed at your feast in heaven, where all creation worships you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessing and honor and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Most merciful Lord, your love compels us to come in. Our hands were unclean, our hearts were unprepared. We were not fit even to eat the crumbs under your table. But you, Lord, are the God of our salvation and share your bread with sinners. So cleanse and feed us with the precious body and blood of your Son, that he may live in us and we in him, and that we, with the whole company of Christ, may sit and eat in your kingdom. Amen. So draw near with faith to receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Our closing prayer that we say together. Holy God, we see your glory in the face of Jesus Christ. May we who are partakers at his table reflect his life in word and deed, that all the world may know his power to change and save. This we ask through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We have a rousing Easter hymn to send us out into this new week. So let's stand to sing together. Thine be the glory. Is there an offering plate? Father God, we thank you for the joy that overwhelms us. We thank you for your precious gifts to us. And we thank you that we can give now of all that you've given us so that others may know that same glory, joy, and hope for themselves. Take and use these gifts now, Father, for your glory. Amen.
Amen.
May Christ, who out of defeat brings new hope and a new future. Fill us with his new life. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with us and remain with us always. Amen.
He's risen indeed.